Well, thank you for being here this morning. It's good to be in God's house and able to worship Him. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you. Blessings that we receive daily are innumerable. We thank you that we're admonished throughout the Word of God from the Old and New Testament. In everything, give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus. The good and the bad. Sometimes we don't understand, but one thing we know, we serve an awesome God. A God who never makes a mistake. Sometimes we may have questions. You know, always revert back to those wonderful passages in your Word. They tell us how awesome you are. They tell us we can never be separated from the love of God in Christ Jesus. On and on it goes. And then you've given to the hymn writers the great hymns of the faith. Have faith in God when your pathway is lonely. He sees and knows all the way you have trod. Never alone or the least of His children. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. And so, Father, in these times that we live, that sometimes we don't understand particularly the evil that has risen around us, may we always keep our eyes upon Jesus. And this morning, Father, a thousand things that could distract us from worshiping the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The devil would put a multitude of things in our minds this morning. So I pray, Father, that you would enable us through the Holy Spirit to ward off all those thoughts that are contrary to worship. And allow us this morning to worship in a manner that would honor and glorify you, in a manner that would build us up in the faith. I pray for Greg, Cindy, the choir, as they lead us in worship through music this morning. I pray if there's someone here this morning who's never received Christ, I pray this morning the Holy Spirit of God would draw them into a saving relationship with the Lord Jesus, in whose name I pray. Amen. Amen. Together in our responsive reading, giving thanks. It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord and to sing praises unto thy name, O Most High. Upon an instrument of 10 strings, and upon the psaltery, upon the harp with a solemn sound. O Lord, how great are thy works, and thy thoughts are very deep. When the wicked spring as the grass, and when all the workers of iniquity do flourish, it is that they shall be destroyed forever. For lo, thine enemies, O Lord, for lo, thine enemies shall perish.
All the workers of iniquity shall be scattered.
The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree. He shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon.
Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God.
They shall bring forth fruit in their old age. Amen and amen. If we may be seated, we're going to have prayer time.
Song is We Are an Offering. So let's stand together and sing We Are an Offering.
Thank you. pray that these tithes and offerings won't just be used to keep the lights on in the church, but it will be used to turn some lights on in some hearts, Father.
Amen.
And we just thank you for that, Lord.
Amen.
I say a special prayer for the people whose names are in this treasure box that we have up here, Father, that we love them, but you love them even more, Father. We just thank you for that, Lord. At this time also, I pray for our service and our country, that we would once again become one nation under God, Father. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God, who is abundant in mercy because of his great love that he had for us, made us alive with the Messiah, even though we were dead in his trespasses. By grace, you are saved.
Not to us, Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory because of your faithful love, because of your truth.
Thank you.
some of you Baptists are going to make it before you go through a place to teach you how to praise God, you know. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him. Thank you, Greg. That's my theme this month, to give praise and give thanksgiving to God. Ben just returned from spending a few days down in the Bahamas, bathing in the sun. Down there trying to help begin the process of recuperating churches and homes, and he's going to share it with us briefly this morning. Then Wednesday night, he's going to give us a greater, bigger presentation of what's going on there and how you and I can be a part of helping. We're so blessed. Mom and I were talking the other day. I think we may live in the best part of the country. Because we rarely have these kind of storms and this kind of damage. And so when it happens, I'm so glad that we have the privilege of responding. And Ben was with a group. He'll tell you about them and tell you a little bit about it. And then Wednesday night, he'll finish that up. So come on, Ben.
To have been able to be a part of what is the beginning of our response to help those people down there. The people in the Bahamas, or at least the people on Grand Bahama Island where we were, I can't speak. You know, if you look on a map and you see where the Bahamas are, there's a whole bunch of islands around there. This is Grand Bahama Island, and Freeport is the big city there, and that's the coast where all the cruise ships come in to Freeport. 2 months ago, and we're just now getting there, but 2 months ago, this area was hit by a hurricane that stalled. And for 2 days, four high tides, it set right there in the same place over Grand Bahama Island. I cannot express to you how devastating that was. Have you got any pictures, Wanda? That is a church that some men were working on as we passed in our travels. Let's show another one, Wanda. Investors had bought up or leased out acres and acres. You can stop right there, Wanda. Just go back to the pine trees. Acres and acres and acres, and they had planted pine trees. And for about the third or fourth time, they got wiped out before they came to completion. These pine trees, you can see the size of them. They're not nearly harvest size. They had 25 feet of water in this area right here for 2 days, and the pines are all dead. There were dead pine trees all over this island. I think the investors have finally given up on their raising pine trees. But you got to understand, the Bahamas import every 2x4 that they get from the United States. They import all of their shingles and all of their sheetrock from the United States. They don't produce any of that. The cars we rode in over there were all cars that came from America. They'd buy an old used car in America and for $1,000 ship it over there, and that was the cars that they had. Move on one just a little bit further. That's a shipping container that wound up in the yard of this destroyed house. Where it came from, who knows? That's a truck buried in the debris that washed ashore. There were many, many cars all over the place, all over the island, that were disabled and sitting sideways, upside down, up against houses, up against trees, just wrecked, ruined cars. We found oodles of people living in tents. One time you got out of Freeport, and you headed toward the northern end of the island, people, the only places people could live were tents. The houses were all destroyed. And we saw tents that bore the emblem of Rotary International. We saw tents from Samaritan's Purse. We saw tents from a number of different charitable organizations. We ran across some guys operating drones, doing a survey for the government so they could get pictures from overhead of everything that had happened all on the whole island. We ran across the Red Cross in one place, but you know what? We also ran across some Scientology people there. Their missionaries were out there. Jehovah's Witnesses have sent in missionaries as well. So what we do is critically, critically, critically important. Just another picture of wasted cars in a house. Another picture of houses. Another picture of houses. 185 mile an hour winds. Can you imagine that? I can't imagine it. These are some people that was a picture of where the people were there with the drones, and they were surveying the damage to the islands. Okay. Devastation everywhere you look. That's a church. That is a church. There are 10 churches in the Zion Baptist Association. And I don't know how many of them are totally destroyed, but I would imagine about half of them are just about wiped out. And this is the Christian witness. This is where we can be part of helping, as we help here. We've ran across some workers there. This is the only place on the whole, running the whole length of the island, that we saw major work going on remodeling something or rebuilding something. Just utter destruction. There used to be a village here. Okay. I got one picture that I really thought was neat, and it's a picture of a telephone booth standing there in the middle of sand, and that's all it was, just a telephone booth. The people there depend on us. It was hard not to believe that you were in America because of the people. The people were very friendly and helpful and very thankful for anything that we could do to help them. We went into a church called Carvel Zion Baptist Church, and that church had 4 feet of water in it. The churches there were beautiful, beautiful churches. Some of them that we were in were shells, and we just saw what had been there. But Carvel Zion with 4 feet of water in it, and we worked with Pastor Mack. Pastor Mack, boy, he's an inspiration. But he's working to rebuild things in his congregation. He said, sadly, he had some people that had not been back to church because of the storm, because they were angry at God. He had people that had not come back to church because they didn't feel like they had good enough clothes to wear to come to church. And he said he was really struggling with that, and he was struggling with how to deal with these people. The devastation that went the length of the island, it was not as devastated in Freeport. Freeport, you got to understand, they don't have mortgages for houses there. There's some wealthy people that had built houses there, but the other people passed houses down from generation to generation. Everything was built on a slab. We saw house after house that was uninhabitable. Some of the people had stripped a lot of the stuff out of their houses, and it's all piled up by the side of the road. The government just can't get to it quick enough. There's just so much, so much, so much. We had the privilege. We came together, a group of six of us that had never seen each other before. And we tore the sheetrock 4 feet high all the way through that church. Just imagine if we had to go 4 feet high right here and tear all the sheetrock out of this church and tear all the carpets up. And we went all through where we worked mainly was in the Sunday school rooms and places and offices and places like that, gutting it out and then treating it for mold, because that's a terrible thing. When you pull the sheetrock off the wall, you know what we found behind the wall? Black mold. And it was everywhere. And when you hit it with the mold remediation spray, it puffed up, kind of as a death throw. But we cleaned it out. We were the first group in. And our task was simple, was to get the sheetrock out of that church and get that church cleaned up. We succeeded in getting that done. There's much, much more to be done. The churches in that area, this church has been a center for the distribution of water and food to people that didn't have it. And this church, things have got to continue forward. We've got to get back there and got to get that sheetrock up in that church. Then that church can be whole and can function again. We worshiped with a group at, what's the name of the other church? Anyhow, Upper Zion Baptist Church. And their church was not damaged. This is where we slept during the week. But Wednesday night, we worshiped with those folks. And oh, did they sing. We had to be careful we didn't pull them off key. I told Greg they had a lady there with a tambourine sitting on the second pew. And she, dush, 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 and she kept time, and that was the music that we had. And we must have sung for half an hour. We worship God. And these people were serious about it. These people all have kin people in the United States. They visit the United States. They come up here. One guy was telling us he had never seen snow, but he had a son that lived in Detroit. But every time he ever got up to see his son, said there was either snow already in the ground or it snowed already on the ground or it snowed the day after he left. He said, I want to see some snow so bad. The women of the churches fed us all week. We went up there prepared to buy food and prepare our own sandwiches and stuff. But they fed us. Did they have much? No, but they shared with us what they had. Oh, what a great need it is there. Over the coming months, we owe that to these people that are just like us, only in a terrible jam. Just look at riding down the road and looking at everything piled out by the side of the road, it touched my heart. And I said, that's people's lives. That's people's lives sitting out there on the side of the road. And yet these people were happy. They were moving on. We need to pray for Pastor Mack and Pastor Pender. We need to pray for these pastors that are trying to lead these churches in this time of trouble and trying to meet the needs of broken people. Our prayer is for spiritual revival in the Bahamas. God has a plan in everything that he does. This can be a time of great spiritual revival in the Bahamas. Our part is to help our sister churches. One more thought. We went to Pelican Point at the end of the island, and Pelican Point was devastated. The church at Pelican Point was gutted out. There is a barge filled with building materials supplied by the Southern Baptist. And there's a coalition of North Carolina, Mississippi, and Alabama of people that are going there to work over a period of time to repair that. Our response, our association's response, is going to be working with the churches in the Freeport area to help to try to restore sanity to the whole situation. It is a great need. We need to respond. We need to help these people in the way that we can. Because it's hard to tell being there from being in America as far as the people go, because they rely on us for so much.
Thank you very much, Ben. If you did not read the article in the Baptist Courier last week, and you need to, I think most of our families get the Courier. Mike Wallace, who is our assistant DOM, is actually heading up for the South Carolina Baptist Convention, the work that we're doing there. And I've talked to, by the way, Mike had his surgery Friday, is doing well. I talked to him and Mike O'Dell, and we'll have more to say about how we might help financially in time. As far as material, the labor is being provided by folks like Ben and the others. Would you bow with me in a moment of prayer? Father, we thank you that we're blessed to be spared the devastation that the people, not only in the Bahamas, but in other parts of our country, suffered during this tremendous hurricane that did so much damage. Thank you for folks like Ben and the others who have gone. And over a period of time, Father, we'll continue to go to try to help restore some of the facilities of the churches and the homes of the people, as well as providing spiritual help in a time like this. There's so many organizations, Father, that have lovingly responded, and we thank you for Southern Baptist, always at the forefront when a disaster like this takes place, thank God for a great denomination that has always risen up to be some of the first people on the scene in helping feed and provide spiritual help and assistance and rebuilding churches, rebuilding homes, most importantly, rebuilding lives. And so, Father, I pray that you would touch the hearts of many, many, many across this country, including us right here at Union, that we might understand what we might better do, Father, to help people who are in dire straits at this very moment. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your mercy that we've sung about this morning. We thank you for your unending grace, for your love from which we cannot be separated. We give you tremendous thanks for that this morning, and we do so in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Today begins what is basically probably the two busiest months of the year. Two of the most important holidays of the year are beginning, November, December, Thanksgiving. God placed it upon my heart some days ago to put a very, very special emphasis upon giving thanks to God. As Ben has said, there are people that don't have what we have this morning. There are churches that cannot meet in their buildings as it once did because their buildings have been destroyed. And Father, and we're here this morning, thanks be to God, in a very beautiful place where we can worship God. We have a piano, we have a pianist, we have a music director, we have a choir, and we have a congregation this morning. They don't have those things. And so we are a very blessed, a very thankful people. And yet, you know what has happened to us? I've watched it. You know, it won't be long. Mark my word, it won't be long until about Memorial Day, and that's when. When's Memorial Day? Memorial Day happens in May. It won't be long until they start the Christmas celebration in May. It won't be long, I promise you, because I don't know. They've crept this thing backwards, and I noticed in some of the places like Sam's, Walmart, and Kohl's, and some of the places, they've had Christmas decorations now for months. And television, they're promoting and spending millions already on television. And what has happened to us, we have just allowed them to just about push Thanksgiving out of the way. And it's all Christmas. And yet there should not be a more thankful people in the world than the people of the United States of America. And it's my prayer, it's my desire that during the month of November I will be able to instill in my heart and instill in your heart a greater degree of giving thanks every single day to God. Thanksgiving Day was begun, as best I can discover, in 1621 in Plymouth Colony, when the Puritans gave thanks for their first harvest in a new world. With a biblical eloquence, I read, Governor Bradford spoke, and he said, and I quote, "Our fathers were Englishmen, which came over this great ocean and were ready to perish in this wilderness. But they cried unto the Lord, and he heard their voice, and he did, and looked on their adversities. Let us therefore," Governor Bradford said, "let us therefore praise the Lord, because he is good and his mercies endured forever." And thus began that spirit of praise, that spirit of giving thanks to God. But in time, what happened to us? We've allowed it this day and time, even we've allowed it even more to happen. We talk about the world. Let's quit blaming the world, Christians. We are the ones who have allowed the materialistic world to creep in the church, and we have become more like them than they have become like us. We looked at Peter on this past Wednesday night, and very quickly, you remember that the thing that Peter said most in that first epistle, Peter said, "You're in the world, but don't let the world be in you. Be a separate, be a distinct people, be a different kind of people." And yet, we have allowed the world to creep in to where they have robbed us of some of our greatest opportunities to give praise and thanksgiving to God. And then another that I read this week. It was in 1863. During some of the most difficult days Abraham Lincoln spoke, and he said, and I quote, "We have forgotten the gracious hand which has preserved us in peace and multiplied and strengthened us. And we have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts." Listen to this. Oh, how any preacher could stand in the pulpit today and repeat the same words of Lincoln. "We have allowed the blessings that God has produced. We have allowed ourselves to believe that by our own superior wisdom, we have created these blessings. Intoxicated with unbroken success." You see, that's what happens when I write one day and try to read it 2 days later, I can't read it. We have become intoxicated with unbroken success. We have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace. Too proud to pray to the God. Any pastor could stand in any pulpit in America today and repeat those same words, because we too, in the intoxication of our success, we have become ourselves responsible for it, rather than giving thanks and praise to Almighty God, because He alone is responsible for everything that we have. This place that we worship in this morning, these bodies of ours, the home from which we came this morning, we are not responsible for them. God is. And we have become too proud, as Lincoln said, to pray to the God that made us. A little closer to where we are today. Peter Marshall, like so many that we have known, went home to be with the Lord, what I consider way too early. Great, great Presbyterian. Chaplain of the United States Senate for some years. He said on the floor of the Senate in November 26 of 1947, "If we do not have the grace to thank Thee for all that we have and enjoy, how can we have the audacity to seek Thy further blessings?" Peter Marshall said, "God, give us grateful hearts." If there's anything that I have prayed that God has spoken so clearly to my heart about, and God has spoken to my heart, no doubt in my mind, this past week, God has just overwhelmed me. If any of you, and I know some of you do, I know Andy's told me a couple of times that he listens to Dr. Stanley on Saturday evening, and I know that he comes on some stations on Sunday morning. If you know anything about the preaching and the teaching and the writing of Dr. Charles Stanley, one of his big themes is be listening always for God to speak a word to you. If I were to go through this congregation this morning, and boy, this just overwhelmed me this week, and that God spoke to me in so many different ways. You see, God speaks through this book. God speaks through the Holy Spirit. God speaks through circumstances. If you're looking and listening for God to speak, I promise you faithfully, God will speak to you. And so God spoke to me about this subject of rushing into Christmas, rushing into wanting things instead of taking the time and giving the time to just simply say, "God, I thank you," every single day. There are three major things that came to my heart and mind this week as I meditated upon this subject, and God just would not leave me alone. three major themes. And I think the more I looked at it and the more I made notes, the more I realized that it could well be that these three major themes that I'm going to share with you very quickly this morning, that all of the other blessings that we receive somehow fall under these three great themes. And so let me just share with you this morning very quickly three things that I think everything else can somehow fall under this morning. You know what the greatest blessing is? That is a blessing of salvation. I mean, friend, if you don't have nothing else, I mean, it's like the folks down in the Bahamas, and some of them is being said lost everything. If you had nothing left this morning, but you were true, blood-bought, born-again, child of God, you know what? You'd have everything in the world to give God praise and give God thanksgiving for. I'm saved. Howard and I, Howard came in this morning, sat down, and I'm going to skip that, Howard. You remind me, I'm going to come back to that. I'll make that the last point. Howard and I were sharing some things this morning. Let me tell you something. If you're saved, you have everything. You've been forgiven of your sins. They've been covered by the blood of Jesus. Lord Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, has come to dwell in your heart. And you begin to think, and let me just say, what did you say? You see, y'all don't think I remember much. What did you say Wednesday night about Ephesians, about this week's lesson? You don't remember it, do you? I do. What did you say? Just read it. And he's right, buddy. If you read that lesson this week, now all of them are great. This one this week would just set you on fire, wouldn't it, Bobby? I mean, if you saved, you realize that all the things that Paul said in that book of Ephesians, and particularly, in fact, I meant to bring the lesson up this morning and read part of what Paul said about being thankful for your salvation. That God has given us so much mercy. God has bestowed so much grace upon us. And God has showered us with so much love. I mean, friend, some of you are saying, well, I don't have much as some other people. And I think that sometimes. I have to every once in a while, I get a little jealous. Any of you ever get jealous? Well, you're liars if you ain't jealous. Every once in a while, I have to open this book. And I know where I'm going, so don't think I don't know where I'm going. I know where I'm going. I have to flip over here. I'm just showing you that I know how to flip through the Bible. I have to flip over here to Psalm 73. If you haven't read it lately, I read it once in a while. Truly God is good to Israel, even to such as are of a clean heart. But as for me, Asaph said, my feet were almost gone. My steps had well nigh slipped. And it goes on and on through those 28 verses. And what had happened to Asaph is that Asaph had become jealous of the people around him who had more materially than he himself had. But then he comes down to realize that, but in the end, hallelujah, praise God, in the very end, I'm going to be the winner and they're going to be the losers. I don't know why y'all want me to exercise so much this morning. In the end, I'm going to be the winner and they're going to be the losers, because God, by his mercy and his grace and his love, he saved me. And I have everything I'll ever need because Jesus lives in my heart. Now, you get the feeling like I do sometimes that all these other people out here are faring a whole lot better than I'm faring. They may be materially, but you don't know what's going on inside their heart. This I know, Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God, lives in my heart. And all through this month of November, I want you to take some time every single day just to pause and say, Lord, I want to thank you that by your grace and by your mercy and by your love, you chose me, you elected me, you foreordained me to be your child.
Amen.
And do that every single day. Now we'll go back to Howard here. I got 7 minutes. I got longer than that. Okay, Howard, you tell me. See, I remember this. I want to see if you remember. Now, what did you tell me sitting in the office this morning? About every day, what do you do?
Talk to somebody about the Lord. Either an unbeliever or a believer.
You do that about once a month?
No, I do it about every day.
Man, if you're truly thankful that God saved you by his grace, you'll do what Howard does every day. You'll not let a day pass that you don't give thanks to God that by his grace he saved you. Amen?
Amen?
Now what if in the month of November, this month, that every single one of us never let a single day pass by that we didn't tell somebody how grateful we were that Jesus saved us? Do you think that'd make a difference? It'd make all the difference in the world. You know what? It'd make you feel better. I mean, why do you want to hide something? Why do you want to hide something that has so much value wrapped up in it? It was Saturday. 2 weeks ago, wasn't it, Mom? She and I were sitting on our porch where we sit most of the time when we're at home. Neighbor had come over to visit with us. That's unusual today. He probably came over to borrow something. He just never did get around to asking us, probably. No, he's a great guy. Telephone rang. In fact, Donald Trump called me yesterday. He said, "This is Donald." I said, "How you doing, Donald?" Hung up. I didn't have time to talk to Donald Trump yesterday. He probably called some of you yesterday. Did Donald call any of you yesterday? Huh? He called me yesterday. You know what he wanted? Money. So a boy called me 2 weeks ago on Saturday and said, "Did y'all, it's a true story." He said, "Mr. Long, have you gotten one of those letters in the mail?" And I said, "No, sir, I don't think I have." He said, "Well, I'm calling to inform you that you have just won the sweepstakes. You have just won $2.5 million. Well, I got excited. He finally said, "Mr. Long, you need to settle down a little bit. You're too excited." I said, "Who wouldn't be excited about winning $2.5 million? Well, he goes on a little bit. And I said, "Now, what do I need to do? How quick can I get this $2.5 million? "We can deliver it to you today." He's got this foreign accent. He said, "Now, Mr. Long, what's your bank?" I told him. He said, "Now, what's that number?" I told him. I lied. I didn't tell the truth. You're going to take it that way. Now, let me tell you something, seriously. Your salvation, your relationship with God in Jesus is worth more than all the money in this world. Because as Asaph said in Psalm 72, one day these guys are going to leave it all behind. And you're going to take all the treasures that you've laid up in heaven. You're going to go to receive them. Now, folks, in November, don't let a single day pass by that you don't tell somebody about Jesus. Second thing, real quickly. Second thing that came to my mind is be thankful for your country. Boy, there is nowhere else in the world that a people have been blessed more than they have been blessed in these United States of America. I mean, just sit down and recount your blessings. We could take the Bill of Rights if we had time this morning. Let's talk about each one of those Bill of Rights. Look at what the people in Hong Kong are having to endure today. Look at the suffering they're going through, trying to maintain their freedoms that they're probably in time going to lose. And if we aren't careful, we're on a slippery slope as America. We too may lose some of our freedom if we don't stand up for what's right and what's good and what our forefathers have bequeathed to us. Be thankful for America. Somebody, don't be ashamed to, hey man, I want you to know I'm glad I live here. I want you to know I'm glad the freedom. I'm glad I've got a Bible to read. I'm glad I've got freedom of speech. I'm glad I've got a home. I'm glad I've got a family. I'm glad I have a right to bear arms. On and on and on you might go. And you could keep expanding on that fact of living in America. And then the third, very quickly. The third thing that came to my mind, and one of the most important things that God has given me that I can be thankful for, is God has given me a place at the end of this life in heaven where there'll be no more sickness, sorrow, or pain. Former things are passed away.
Amen.
I mean, you read that. You read ASAP again. Go back and read that song. I read it. I read it every once in a while because I will remind myself, you know, I'm not on the losing end of the stick. I'm on the winning end of this stick. Because you see, I know I'm not going to take it with me. I've got sense. You see, some people live as if they're going to just sort of, Gene, where's Gene? Y'all remember the picture Gene gave me? I'd always said I'd never seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul behind it, and Gene found a picture and gave it to me, and that just, you know, canceled out all of that. But the truth is you're not going to take it with you. Boy, as you get older, and I say to people oftentimes who are getting old like me, it ain't a lot of fun sometimes getting old. When you look at your calendar for the week, and Mary will say, well, now which doctors do we visit this week? You know what I'm talking about? You know, Friday, I think we had two different appointments on Friday, and almost every week we've got these appointments. You see, one day, there aren't going to be any doctors in heaven. Hope to God they are, you know. Hope they are, but they aren't going to be practicing medicine on me.
Amen.
Because I'm going to be completely whole, and you're going to be completely whole. All of these pains, and Gadsden's home this morning with some back problems. Thank God, Cindy, when he gets to heaven, he won't have any back problems. Thank God, Cindy's not going to have any blood clots. Cindy's not going to have any blood clots. You're not going to have all. So there are three things real quickly, and my time is gone, that you can be thankful for and put everything within those. You're thankful for your salvation. You're thankful you live in America, and you're thankful that God has planned and prepared for you. As he said in John 14, God has planned and God has prepared for you a place in heaven one day. Now, here's what I want to challenge you to do. It's not enough just to say to God every day, I'm thankful. Live it. That's what Paul said. Paul said, if you're truly thankful, live like you are a thankful person to God for all he's given to you. And boy, this lesson this week, it spelled that out so clearly this week, especially. I've read it many times before, but somehow God just spoke to me and said, now if you really thank me, live like you're thankful. But not only quickly, give thanks to God, give thanks to others. Every day, you're going to tell somebody how thankful you are for Jesus. And then every day you're going to tell somebody, either tell them in person or write them a note and say, I'm thankful for you. You see, I'll be kept busy all month by writing a lot of notes to people. You know, I thank you. I thank you, Ted, for being Ted. Thank you for being for what you do. Thank you for Greg, for all that you do in the church and on and on. We ought to be a thankful people. Don't let the world, the devil, rob us of the greatest blessing that we could possibly receive during this month of November. Just give. Don't think about what you're going to get. Think about what you're going to give. Amen? Don't think about what you're going to get. It's greater to be a giver than it is to be a getter. One thing that Scripture has really beat me up on is when Peter and Paul was both speaking about one of the great sins of Christendom is greed. Be glad, be thankful, be giving. Bow with me in prayer. God's good to us, folks. My heart has been overwhelmed. I cannot tell you how God has just hovered about me this. If God hasn't spoken to you lately, hey, let me tell you something. Get alone in a room somewhere with just you and God and ask God the reason. God speaks every... I mean, I got up this morning, went out cold as it was, looked out there on my bird feeder post, and you know what? The food was gone. In the cold, I restored the food, and it wasn't long as I stood there. The birds came. You know what? That blessed me. And I said, thank you, God, Father. On the way to church this morning, beautiful hawk flew over us. Thank you, Father. Yesterday, Mom and I saw 5 deer in our little neighborhood. I said, thank you, God, for those deer. Friend, if you open your eyes and you open your ears, every single day, God will bless you. Give him thanks for it, for something. Father, I thank you. I don't even know how to say because you've been so good to this old man. You've been so gracious to us. You have blessed Mary and I beyond anything that we could possibly ever imagine. Just a privilege of being a part of this great family of God we call Union Baptist Church. That in itself is an awesome blessing. To be part of a family, the family of God, a family that cares for one another, the family that loves one another, the family that just is always willing and ready just when somebody has a need. I've watched it and been blessed by it. Where can we pitch in? Where can we help? What can we do? Lord, I thank you for that this morning. I thank you for the talent wrapped up in this church. I thank you for what the Sunday school teachers do. I thank you for what the choir members do. I thank you for what the... Lord, I especially thank you for what those ladies in the kitchen, those men on Wednesday night do. Feed us. Thank you. Thank you for that blessing. But most of all, and far beyond all, I want to thank you that one day you chose me, you elected me, you foreordained me to become a part of the family of God, and you wrote my name in the Lamb's Book of Life in heaven. And Father, if you took all this other stuff away from me, if like the people in the Bahamas, and Mom and I can somehow identify with that having lost some things recently materially, but we had insurance. We had friends. We had help. But if I lost it all, if I still had Jesus, which I would and I do, I could say, hallelujah, praise the Lord, thank you, a million times over, and could never express it quite enough. And I pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Now for some announcements. Come here, Mama. You said you wanted to speak this morning. Come on. Mom and I were not here last Sunday, as some of you know. I hope you were here. Mom and I went back to where it all began, didn't we? We went to the First Baptist Church in Rock Hill, where we were married. 57 years ago. Now, I did not mention this in the sermon. But next to my salvation, that's the greatest gift God ever gave me. Right there. And we want to thank you. I want her to come up here because you see, what you did for us last week was not just for me, it was for me and her. And I gave her that check, Bob, as soon as we got home. I put it in her hand. Y'all understand? Y'all gave me a monetary gift. I gave it to her. And then one of the biggest gifts you gave us is Thomas got me a book signed by the President's Seminary, one of his latest book. I can't say thank you enough for being part of this family. And Mom and I talk about it every day. When we went to First Baptist last week, we talked about, now we're coming back here one day, of where we're going, you know. Sometime soon. But there's no place like Union Baptist Church and no people like the people at Union Baptist Church. And I can tell you that from the depths of my heart. Having been in a number of churches and been blessed in those places, this is the best place we've ever been. And we thank God for it a million times over. Iggy back here on the back row is ready to take your money for the poinsettias. Ready. See her this morning. A lot easier to get out of the way. $10 for your poinsettia in memory and honor of a loved one. Now I want you to come to the altar to pray before we leave this morning. I want it to be the last thing that Greg's going to lead us in our closing song. I want many of you to come to this altar and pray this morning with us. I want to give thanks to you and for you and give thanks to God. So come and let's just join around this altar this morning and give thanks to God for all his blessings. And deacons, please come and play. This box has become a big burden to my heart. And I wish I had time this morning to tell you two stories that happened to me this week. Next Sunday, you remember that, what's her name? Judy's going to be here next Sunday to give her testimony. She set our ladies on fire a few weeks ago in their women's meeting. She's going to be here next Sunday morning. At the end of the service, you'll have an opportunity to give a generous gift to her and her work with her children in Kenya. Father God, thank you. Mom and I can't say thank you enough because you have, by your plan, not by our plan, because Lord, this isn't what we had planned, but by your plan, you brought Mom and I, Union Baptist Church, some years ago. I didn't know why, but you knew why. And Father, you have blessed us in ways through these people we would never have been blessed otherwise. And Lord God, my heart is to see this church become so strong, become a leading church in Western York County of loving people and leading people to faith in Jesus Christ. I have some children's names in this box. Perhaps every one of us do, Father, and I'm concerned. If there's anything you showed me this past week through some circumstances that I encountered. America is spinning out of control and much quicker than most people think. And if our loved ones are going to come to know Jesus, it can't be a year from now, 2 years from now. It needs to be now. It's the Holy Spirit of God. I don't know all the names in this box. I know some of them because they're my own, and I place them there. But Heavenly Father, may the power of the Holy Spirit of God reach into those hearts and lives and minds. First of all, your word says when the Spirit comes, he'll convict of sin, righteousness, and judgment. So Holy Spirit of God, there's where it begins, with your convicting those people that they're lost, they're on the way to hell, and they need Jesus. And Lord, if we can do something, help us to be Howards. If there's something we can do for our loved ones beside praying for them, if there's a word we can share, if there's a witness we can give, God help us. I pray that November, when I come next Sunday, Father, I pray there'll be some people ready to stand up and say, Pastor, I want you to know this week, I gave thanks to God every day for saving me. And I want you to know that I shared with some people who blessed me. I shared some of those blessings with them. Lord, just bless us. Thank you. Thank you for this church. Thank you for every person who works, our deacons, Sunday school teachers, our choir, our committee members who work so tirelessly. But Lord, it's not our work that gets the work done. It's the Holy Spirit of God that has to work through our work to get things done that honor Jesus. We love you. We praise you. We appreciate you. We give you thanks this morning. Lead us, guide us, and direct us by thy mighty power. I pray Wednesday evening as Ben shares these photos more and shares, and then next Sunday as Judith comes, I pray, Father, that in advance of whatever's done, Holy Spirit will be at work in all of our hearts, leading and guiding and directing us. And we pray that in Jesus' name, for Jesus' sake. Amen. 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 God bless you. Wednesday night. Okay? Wednesday night.
Sing our closing song, Learning to Lead.